Hi everybody, it's me Carmen, finally touching bases. I'm going to do a separate update. I think I have about three videos I'm going to do, but I am not going to leave this spot until I get them all done. A few things. My windows are open. It's hot here in California, and so the kids are out in the pool, so you might hear some background noise. And then I have fans on. So I'm going to try to stay focused. One of the things that's very easy to do is lose focus. But I really missed you guys. I miss being away from you guys. I have missed you tremendously. I noticed the emails slowed, the comments slowed, the check-in slowed. So I thought, well, I got to put some videos up to let people know what's going on in my life. Or people just kind of slowly lose interest. That's just human nature. So I want to say, hey, what's up? What you doing? How you doing? What's going on in your life? Touch bases and let me know. Because I still think about you guys every single day. And that's the God's honest truth. I don't go a day without thinking about my YouTube people. I want to use this time on this video to just kind of encourage you all, just give you some scriptures, some healing scriptures, and some things that can possibly help your bad days become good days. There's various versions that I use. I think I use NIV, NLT, The Message, The Amplified, and maybe one or two others. I may have used like the King James Version or New King James Version. But I had promised this weeks ago, and I went through, what I did is I just kind of went through and made notes of scriptures from the Old Testament through the New Testament. And I'll have to kind of do them in segments so that it doesn't end up being too long. So I'm going to just share with you all just some things to help encourage you, especially my loopies, my fellow loopies, and people that's going through any kind of autoimmune disease, any kind of, physical challenges, anything, whether it's cancer, sickle cell, or whatever the case might be. Just some things to kind of meditate on. Now, one of the things that's going to really be important is when you read scriptures, when there's one that really, really touches your heart, really, really ministers to your spirit and your soul, meditate on that. All of these scriptures won't be, for every one person, but there may be one or two or three that particularly just kind of grabs your heart, and then those are the ones that you should, kind of cling to and meditate on day and night. If you're having a bad day, use those scriptures and to remind yourself of God's promises that go back generations and generations and thousands of years, because they don't change. What He promised from day one, He promises until the last day. So just remember that as I read through some of these scriptures, okay? The first one I'll read is, and I have to apologize for my voice because it's kind of shaky today, but it's likely because of I've been so, active and everything for the days preceding today that I'm just kind of a little weak, but it's okay. Just bear with me as I read, okay? All right, Numbers 23:19. I think I took this one from the NIV. It says, God is not human that he should lie. Not human, not a human being that he should change his mind. Does he speak and then not act? Does he promise and not fulfill? And one of the reasons I pulled that out is because I want you to really understand that God really stands behind his word. He will not promise you something in the word of God and not fulfill it. So anything that you read in the word of God, you can hold your life on that, and he will do it for you. 1 Chronicles 28:20 from the Message says, David continued to address Solomon, take charge, take heart, do not be anxious or get discouraged. God, my God, is with you in this. He won't walk off. He won't leave you in the lurch. He's at your side until the very last detail is completed for conducting the worship of God. So whatever is upon your life to do and fulfill in your life, he's not going to cut that short. You have to know and believe that God will not take you out of here before your time. And if you feel like your time on earth has not yet been fulfilled, then you need to remind God of this scripture and remind him of his promises and just appeal to him and say, you know, I don't know what has come upon me, but my time here has not been fulfilled, and I don't want to depart here before my time. And believe me, he will honor it. Psalms 91:10-16 is one that I'm going to read with my name in it, but you can go to this chapter. The whole 91st chapter of Psalms is really a good Psalms to stand on when you're in trouble. Not just physical challenges, but you could be in trouble financially. You could be in trouble on your job. You could be having some, you know, difficulties with another person. Whatever it is, Psalms 91 is the place to start, okay? And where you hear my name, Carmen, you will replace with your name, okay? And this is Psalms 91:10-16, all right? And this is Amplified. It says, there shall no evil befall Carmen, nor any plague or calamity come near Carmen's tent or my house. For he will give his angels charge over Carmen to accompany and defend and preserve Carmen in all her ways of obedience and service. They shall bear Carmen up on their hands, lest Carmen shall dash her foot against a stone. Pause. So here is something where God is really promising to protect you, even from stumbling your very toe. That's how concerned God is about your health. That's how concerned God is about your well-being. So he doesn't even want you to stub your toe. That's how important you are to him. Okay, starting back with 13. Carmen shall tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the serpent shall Carmen trample underfoot. So whatever evil might try to come toward me, be it my health, my finances, my family, whatever it is, God says that I shall prevail over them by getting them under my foot. Okay, because Carmen has set her love upon me, therefore I will deliver Carmen. I will set Carmen on high because she knows and understands my name. She has a personal knowledge of my mercy, my love, and my kindness. Trust and relies on me, knowing I will never forsake her. No, never. Carmen shall call upon me, and I will answer her. I will be with Carmen in trouble. I will deliver Carmen and honor her. With long life will I satisfy Carmen and show her my salvation. And show her my salvation. And that's really important, because God is saying here that the more we depend on him, the more that we rely on him, the more that we put our trust in him, the more he will act for us and the more he will prove himself to us. So that's really important to hang your faith on. Genesis 20:17 says, so Abraham prayed to God, and God healed Abimelech and his wife and his female slaves, and they bore children. Okay, there's another act of healing that God performed even back in Genesis. Exodus 23:25-26 says, worship the Lord your God, and his blessings will be on your food and water. I will take away sickness from among you, and none will miscarry or be barren in your land. I will give you a full life span. God promises us a full lifespan. Back in the biblical days, people lived hundreds of years, literally hundreds of years. And it's real important to know that, because there is a lifespan that God promises us in the Bible. And, you know, he will not, you know, he's not man that he should lie, just like the scripture I read previously. And he is not human that he should even have to repent for anything that he said. So therefore, when we read something, be it in the Old Testament or the New Testament, as long as it's a promise of God, it still stands to this day, because he promised that all generations would benefit from his blessings, his healing, and his promises for thousands of generations to come. So you have to know that, and you have to believe that. And what do I do if I don't believe it? Okay, well, if you don't believe it, then ponder it. Meditate on it. Ask God. You know, Paul said, you know, but in the New Testament, one of the men of God prayed and said, God, I believe, but help my unbelief. So there is a portion of you that might believe a little bit, and that's all you need. All you need is the size of a grain of a mustard seed. A mustard seed itself is very small, but you only need a grain of that to start with. And God promised us in his word that he has given unto us the same measure of faith. I didn't get this huge faith just when I was born. We were all, you know, given the same measure. We all started from, you know, base one. And over the 30 years, 32 years that I've been walking with God, I have come to see him do so many things in my life and demonstrate his power, demonstrate his grace and his mercy, his loving kindness, that now there is nothing anyone can say to me that would make me doubt his belief, doubt his mercy, doubt what he did for me on the cross, or doubt him, period. There's nothing anyone can say, because I know for myself firsthand. Okay, moving along. 1 Chronicles 16 and 9 says, thank God, call out his name, tell the whole world he is and what he's done, sing to him, play songs for him, broadcast all his wonders, reveal in his holy name, revel in his holy name. God seekers, be jubilant, study God and his strength, seek his presence day and night, remember all the wonders he performed, the miracles, the judgments that came out of his mouth, the seed of Israel, his servant, children of Jacob, his first choice. He is God, our God. Wherever you go, wherever you come, if you come upon his judgments and decisions, he keeps his commandments across thousands of generations. The covenant he commanded, the same one he made with Abraham, the very one he swore to Isaac, he posted it in big block letters to Jacob. Now, all that is saying is they were trying to convince and reassure Jacob that no matter what, God's promises are still with you. They still apply to you. They still are relevant. They are still alive and working. They are still being thrust upon us every single day. All we have to do is access them. All we have to do is utilize them. It's like if someone says to you, hey, Carmen, I just got you a new car. I hope you enjoy it. All you have to do is go down to, you know, Mercedes-Benz in, you know, Torrance and pick it up. That's all you need to do. Okay? So once I know that it's there, I need to take action to access it. I must then say to my daughter, hey, take me down to Hawthorne Mercedes or Hollywood Mercedes or, you know, San Francisco Mercedes so I can pick up my new car that they have for me there. And if I never go to pick it up, I never have it in my possession. But if I take the time and work on my faith, operate in my faith, move forward in my faith, and I say to someone, hey, come run me over here so I can pick up my new car, and I go down there and I get the keys and I get in it and I put the keys in the ignition and I start it and I put it in gear and I drive off, I'm now in possession of it. I have seized it, I have possessed it, and it is fully mine. It's the same way with God's scriptures on healing and any promises that he has. You must be able to access it once you know it's available. All you got to do is just receive it for yourself. It's simple. Okay. Job 5:26, the NIV version says, you will come to the grave in full vigor like sheaves gathered in the season. There again, he's promising us a full life, and we shall not depart from here before our time. Psalms 30:2, O Lord my God, I cried to you and you have healed me. Amen. Psalms 34:19, many evils confront the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Psalms 41, dignify those who are down on their luck. You'll feel good. That's what God does. God looks after us all. He makes us robust with life. We are lucky to be in the land. We're free from enemy worries. Whenever we're sick and in bed, God becomes our nurse, and he nurses us back to health. Okay? That was Psalms 41. Psalms 102, verses 2 and 3. Do not hide your face from me when I am in distress. Turn your ear to me when I call. Answer me quickly, for my days vanish like smoke. My bones burn like glowing embers. And this is a time when David was down, and that was his prayer to God. He was like, don't hide your face from me. You know, I need you. This is when I need you most. And he said, you know, don't turn your ear from me. When I speak to you, please hear me, Lord. You know, let your mercy be upon me. And God honored his prayer. Psalms 105 and 37. This is the NLV version. Then he brought Israel out with silver and gold, and there was not one weak person among their families. So everyone was prosperous and healthy. And he's concerned about both. Psalms 107 and 20 says, this is the message. It says, some of you were sick because you'd lived a bad life. Your body's feeling the effects of your sin. You couldn't stand the sight of food. So miserable you thought you'd be better off dead. Then you called out to God in your desperate condition. He got you out in the nick of time. He spoke the word that healed you, that pulled you back from the brink of death. So thank God for his marvelous love, for his miracle mercy to the children he loves. Offer thanksgiving and sacrifices. Tell the world what he has done. Sing it out. So he's saying, go and declare what God has done for your body, for your healing, for your family, for your children. Don't hide it. Don't keep it to yourself, because there is people, there's someone who needs to hear what God has done for you. And I think you may remember a video that I did a while back, and I said, I know God didn't bring these ailments up on my body. It was the things that I sowed early in my life, like bad health, bad things that were not good for me, not good for my body. And, you know, it just takes its toll on your body. This body is a corruptible body. It will not live forever, even though my spirit will live forever. My consciousness will live forever. My body will not live forever. And so some of the things I did in my 20s and 30s just came back to haunt me. And I stand on the word of God. I believe that he will not leave before my time. And that's what I stand on. So just know that some of the things that we do All things are not good and profitable for our physical bodies. Sometimes we just need to, you know, pull back on meats, pull back on sweets and candies and refined sugars, and pull back on some things that may not be healthy for us, especially in our current state, and go toward, you know, the things that are good and better for our bodies. You know, get into the grains, get into the beans, get into the vegetables and the fruits and the live foods and the colors of the rainbow. Sometimes just making a simple switch would make us feel so much better, even though we're dealing with something like lupus. Okay? Psalms 147:3, He heals the brokenhearted and bandages their wounds. Another promise. Proverbs 3:7-8, never let yourself think that you are wiser than you are. Simply obey the Lord and refuse to do wrong. If you do, it will be like good medicine, healing for your wounds, and easing of your pains. And these are some of the things that just naturally cause good health and well-being. So, you know, if you're sowing good things into your spirit, soul, mind, and body, you will reap good things. So that's just food for thought. Okay, Proverbs 4:20-22 says, dear friend, listen well to my words. Tune your ears to my voice. Keep my message in plain view at all times. Concentrate. Learn it by heart. Those who discover these words live, and they really live, body and soul. They're bursting with health. These words, when Jesus said in the word that man shall not live by bread alone, he didn't mean that our bodies didn't need bread and food and nourishment. What he meant was, even when you have those things, you're missing the most important thing, and that's the food for the spirit. The word of God is like food to our bodies and marrow to our bones. It is a way for us to get healthy spirit out. Okay? And here's another one, Proverbs 9:11. NIV says, for through wisdom your days will be many and years will be added to your life. So when we use wisdom in our food choices and our health choices, you know, even little things like, you know you have lupus, and you know that you can't do things like you used to. Well, when you use wisdom and plan your days, you know, put on sunscreen, take your UV SPF umbrella, take your, you know, put on, you know, your sunscreen, your sleeves, a hat. When you do things to take care of where you're at the moment, that means that you're taking control. You're doing good things for your body until you get to the end of your trial or the end of your tribulation that you're currently walking through in your physical body. You have to do things to care for it. And so keep that in mind as you believe God for your healing. Proverbs 14:30 says, a heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Oh, Jesus. Some of the things that we do, envy, strife, argument, just being mean, hateful, spiteful. It really affects our health. When we are stressed out, when we are, you know, having a difficult time with just dealing with life around us, people around us, it really can take its toll on our physical health. So, in other words, a heart at peace gives life to the body. Always find your place of peace, whatever you're going through. I don't care where you're at. I don't care what you're facing. I don't care what hit you. I don't care if you're in jeopardy of losing your home, if you're in jeopardy of losing a family member. I don't care. Find your peace. Find a place of peace that you can just move forward and just, and I don't mean no false stuff. I ain't saying fake it till you make it, baby, and all that kind of crap. There are some things you have to fake till you make it, okay? I'm saying find your central peace. peace in any situation, because the Bible said it gives life to your body. But then the reverse of that is when you don't, it is like rotting your very bones. So be careful when you do things, okay? Does this mean that sickness only comes from envy? No, it does not. It means as you read and meditate on scriptures, search your own heart and search your own conscience, and check yourself. You know, where are you at with believing God's promises? Where are you at with his word? If you have any doubts, you know what? You can go to God. I'm not one of those people that say you can't go to God. You got to go to the pastor. You got to go here. You know what? The very first person you should always go to is God. The very first person. You should get on your knees and say, God, I'm confused. I have this ailment in my body. I know you created me to do great things. I don't understand it. Give me understanding. God promised in his word that he who lacks wisdom in anything, ask of God who gives to all men liberally. He will not leave you in the dark about what's going on in your body. He will tell you things to do. He told me this morning some things, you know, this, hey, this is what you need to do. This, and this. I did exactly as he instructed. And as I move forward, you know, even though I have lupus, I'm not even on any treatment for lupus. And I still do so much better than some of the people I've seen. And I don't think that it's, you know, God favors me more than them or anything. It's just that I found my peace. And I talk well to people. I talk well about people. And I don't let any rotting, evil thoughts get into my mind that might cost me in my health. And that's just something I've learned over 32 years. Was it easy to get here? No. It took diligence. It took dedication. It took applying the word to my life every single day. Everything that I do it with consequence. Here's a quick example. I'm not going to take up too much time. But my daughter and I have this rule. It's spoken and unspoken. Where we have journals. We've had journals over the years. We have private things and stuff like that. We have never had to lock our rooms to keep, you know, each other from looking at each other's things, reading our private journals. She can leave her journal right here on my desk. I would never open it and read it. Well, the other day she left her cell phone. And I was like, I always wonder sometimes, some of the things we talk about, she'll share and some things she won't. But we have a very close relationship. And I was thinking, oh my God. You know, I've kind of been itching to get a piece of information she hasn't been willing to give me. And I knew if I took her phone, I could get it. And she had left it here. And she didn't worry about it. She just said, Mom, you can't call me on my phone because I left it at home. She knew I wouldn't touch it and go through it. But I, for a quick moment, thought, oh, all I want is a name. That's all I want is a name. That's all I want. Can I just go in and get the name? And God said no, because you're not going to violate that trust, because she relies on the fact that you rely on me. And I was just like, he spoke up and he said, and it was just like, I've never thought about it before. In fact, the phone had been here all day, didn't even realize it was here, stood over it all day washing my hands, it was right on the sink. And never even paid attention to it. So we have this thing where we do not violate each other. And we just have to kind of check ourselves. There are some things that we probably have done that maybe nobody else realizes that we've done. That's why it's important for us to take the word of God and check it against our own conscience and see if, you know, there's anything we need to clear up with God. We don't need to just go through life and allow things to fester and grow inside our hearts and our you know, minds and things like that. Just kind of check yourself and move forward and make sure that you, you know, believe what he says. And if you don't, just tell him. He can deal with it. Okay. Proverbs 16 and 24 says, pleasant words are as a honeycomb and sweet to the mind and healing to the body. So there's another way to get your healing. Speaking sweet words, you know. Yeah, it's something that the older black people in my family used to always say. They would say something like, you can get more bees with honey than you can with bleep. You know, I won't say the word, but you get the gist of what they were saying. And, you know, that's, I find that to be very true, even though, you know, it was just, you know, one of those sayings that a lot of old people used to speak. But it really holds a lot of truth and fact, because, you know, the way that I confront people, even people who may have done things to me, I confront them in a loving way. Sometimes if I'm angry or upset, I'll have to pray and go before God sometimes, because I really don't want my emotions to take over. I want to remember things like this, you know, if I'm pleasant, that's sweet as a honeycomb, okay? And that's how I want to receive words from other people, so I try to be mindful of that when I speak to others. Isaiah 40 and 29, he gives power to the faint and weary, and to him who has no might, he increases strength, causing it to multiply and making it to abound. Amen. Isaiah 40 and 31, and I only have, I think, one or two more after this. But those who wait for the Lord, who expect, look for, and hope in him, shall change and renew their strength and power. They shall lift up their wings and mount up close to God as eagles. They shall mount up to the sun. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint, or become tired, or ill, or displaced, or diseased in your body. Isaiah 41 and 10 says, fear not, there is nothing to fear, for I am with you. Do not look around you in terror and be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen and harden you to difficulties, and yes, I will help you. Yes, I will hold you up and retain you in my victorious right hand of righteousness and justice. He is so promising. He is so loving and willing to do things for us that he had to send down his only begotten son to come down and to take our place in for this lupus, for cancer, for, you know, arthritis, for our vision, you know, whatever it is, he just loves you that much. You know, and there's a picture that I saw, and it had Jesus on the cross, not actually on the cross, but it had his hands, and the nails weren't in it, but it just showed the wounds from the nails in it, and it said, you know, how much does God love you? And it showed his palms and said, he loves you this much. And I think that's just so trusting and so endearing, because I just love Jesus so much, because he just does so much for me. He has never, ever in 32 years failed me. In 32 years, he has never failed me. And if you want to hear some miraculous stories, I have them. I have them. I have them. I have them. He has been with me since I was 20 years old. I'm 52 now. And he has never, ever, my children became believers because they saw the things that God did. You know, there was a time when it was just me and my three children, and they were young, and we'd all get on the floor and grab hands and pray when we needed a breakthrough on something, and they saw God do it. And then they believed God beyond, you know, any person on this earth. They believed God more than any person on this earth, including me. So, as I leave you with this was very long. I want to apologize for making it so long, but I really wanted to just share a few scriptures with you and just say that I love you. I've missed you so much. I pray God's healing power upon you right now in the name of Jesus. I reach forward and I touch your body physically in the spirit realm. I pray his healing from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet. I dispatch angels to comfort you when you're feeling down. I pray that the word of God is just remains hidden in your heart and be a well that you can draw from when you need to. I just pray that his word, his healing virtue flows through every cell in your body, through every tissue, through every organ, through every area of your body inside out, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet to the tips of your toes. I rebuke and bind illnesses, sicknesses, infections, and diseases and anything that would bring you discomfort. I speak against pain right now. I just pray that the Lord would continue to comfort you wherever you are. I pray that your faith grows, that your understanding of what he's done for you grows. I pray that you talk to him. I pray that you're confident in his promises. I pray that you are able to see his manifestation in your life. I pray that you begin to trust him more. I pray that you begin to hear from him. I pray that he directs your path. I pray that you grow in confidence about who God is. And I just pray this and ask that you agree with me on this according to his word that says, where two or more of you are gathered together, asking and believing, praying for anything, it shall be done by my Father in heaven. And I just thank you all for watching. I miss you. If you're not a subscriber, I ask that you subscribe and leave me some comments. God bless.